In some systems, what we have what is called role-based access control. Role sort of is, you know, what you do, your function perhaps. That may govern what kind of files you can access. If you're human resources or payroll, or you are in a different department, the set of files you can access would depend on what your role in the organization is. So there is role-based access control, or RBAC, that is implemented. It's a little different, so I thought we'll just spend just a couple of minutes talking about it. In role-based access control, remember, rights are for being able to access certain resources, so those are access rights. Those are associated with the role. They're not associated with the user. So the way to think about it, the way you're going to define your policy, access control policy, is going to say, what roles do I have in my system? And for each role, what kind of resources do they need to have access to? So I would say, you know, people in this role can read these files or write these files and things like that. So this part of the policy basically says, you know, access rights are defined for roles, and users who are going to log into the system or authenticate themselves to the system can then take on some roles. So RBAC, the way to think about this is that we don't have direct access rights for users. Users must be activated into one or more roles. And once they assume one or more roles, based on what those roles, you know, give them access to, that's what the user or the process running on this behalf of this user can access. So we're talking enterprise setting. Access may be based on job function or role of a given user. That's where this might make sense. Project manager may have access to all files. Developers or people doing QA or something like that may access files in different way and so on. Payroll manager in your HR function may be able to look at files that have people's salaries and so on because they are payroll manager and things like that. So this is how roles will be defined. Access rights associated with roles, as we said before. And users, when authentication happens and we know who the user is who's logging into the system, we have to then sort of start with authentication, but then be able to activate one or more roles for them. Okay, so role activation is something else that has to be added to this process. The policy defined here, and sort of there are two stages, activating a role for a user and based on that deciding what the user can access. Now, there are some benefits that come when we have role-based access controls. What could be some of these benefits? So first of all, we said our policy defines what roles have what kind of access for resources in the system. So the policy doesn't need to change when, let's say, a certain person leaves the organization. Policy is associated with roles. It's not associated with users. So users coming or going, they don't require changes to the policy the organization has. When a new employee comes, basically we think about what role is appropriate for them. And as soon as we decide their role based on their function, you know, what resources they should have access to automatically happens, because that role along with it has a set of access rights for various resources. And that, as I said, you know, happens automatically as soon as we decided what role this new employee can take. An interesting thing, list privilege, remember, is one of the design principles that we had, which said you should always execute with the smallest number of privileges or access rights that you need to do what is being done at that time. And it's a really damage containment thing. If something goes wrong, you don't negatively impact resources that you had no business having access to at that point. So how does RBAC help you with that? Well, actually it does, because user can start in one role and access a subset of the files that are only available to that role. The user can then switch roles and then go access a different set of roles, a different set of files that are associated with the new role. If you don't have RBAC, you know, user has a UID and has access to everything he or she can ever access. Roles sort of give you this ability to control, saying if you're in a certain role at a given time, only the resources that are needed for that role should be available at that point, and we can do that with RBAC. You know, being able to implement list privileges is a good thing. That is a design principle for systems we want to trust. So RBAC actually enables that. So are the systems, there are actually systems that implement RBAC. SE Linux, we're going to come back to it, is Security Enhanced Linux, actually supports RBAC, and there are others as well.